శుక్లాం వరధరం విష్ణుం శశివర్ణం చతుర్భుజం ప్రసన్నవదనం ధ్యాయేత్ సర్వవిఘ్నోపశాంతయే రామాయ రామభద్రాయ రామచంద్రాయ వేధసే రఘునాథాయ నాథాయ సీతాయ పతయే నమః. డియర్ ఫ్రెండ్స్, వి ఆర్ సీయింగ్ వాల్మీకి రామాయణ అండ్ వి ఆర్ ఇన్ దిస్ అయోధ్య కాండ. ఇన్ ద లాస్ట్ ఎపిసోడ్ వి సా ఎ వెరీ ఇంట్రెస్టింగ్ సీన్ వేర్ సేజ్ భరద్వాజ, వి నో దట్ భరత హ్యాస్ కమ్ టు ద ఫారెస్ట్ అలాంగ్ విత్ ద త్రీ మదర్స్, దట్ ఈస్ కౌసల్య, సుమిత్ర అండ్ కైకేయి, అలాంగ్ విత్ వశిష్ట, అలాంగ్ విత్ ఆల్ ద పబ్లిక్ రిప్రజెంటేటివ్స్ అండ్ ఆల్ దట్. అండ్ లైక్ ఎవ్రీ వన్ ఎల్స్, ఈవెన్ సేజ్ భరద్వాజ ఇనీషియలీ సస్పెక్టెడ్ దిస్ చాప్. హీ సస్పెక్టెడ్ దట్ దిస్ మ్యాన్ ఈస్ కమింగ్ విత్ అ గ్రేట్ ఆర్మీ, వై హీ హెస్ కమ్. సో హీ performed a miracle and did a sort of psychological test on Bharata, and he found that Bharata came out very successfully in that psychological test. He had created a throne, and Bharata did not want to sit on the throne. He visualized Rama as sitting on the throne, and then he took a seat which was meant for minister. So there he displayed that humility, and then he showed that he was not having any desire for the throne. So he is, after all, we have seen that he is, all said and done, he is a great bhakta of Rama. And now, on the next morning, Bharata and all the entourage, they start off, and they want to take leave of Bharadwaja. And at that time, even the queens, they come. Till that time, it seems the queens have not met Bharadwaja. The queens means all these three mothers. Now, while these people are taking leave, and after Bharadwaja tells some general directions about where to go and how to go and what not, all the queens also, they come, they want to take leave of him, they want to touch the feet of Bharadwaja. And that is what we were at in the last episode. We were at that place, and the Kausalya, she was there, and then all the people, they came, and then they touched the feet. And Kaikeyi tatra jagraha charanau savyapatrapa. After Sumitra and Kausalya, they were together, and Kaikeyi was standing next to Bharata. And Kaikeyi also in a very rather apologetic way, because everybody is abusing her, everybody has been finding fault with her, everybody is saying that she is a great sinner and what not. So she was feeling rather ashamed. With that sense of shame and feeling of guilt, she went and touched the feet of sage Bharadwaja. Then sage Bharadwaja, He knows that Kaikeyi is the mother, because Kaikeyi has been standing with Bharata, alone, next to Bharata, while say Kausalya and Sumitra, they were standing away. So probably he knew also, but still he asks, "You please introduce your mothers to me. Who is who? I just want to know." Then we see Bharata, how he introduces. యామ్ ఇమాం భగవన్ దీనాం శోక అనశనకర్షితాం. యు సీ, అండ్ దిస్ లేడీ హూ ఈజ్ నౌ వెరీ ఫ్రెయిల్ థిన్, అండ్ దెన్ ఉపవాస కృష, షీ హెస్ డన్ సో మెనీ ఉపవాస, షీ హెస్ బీన్ ఫాస్టింగ్, అండ్ దెన్ షీఈస్ సో సాడ్. సో షీఈస్ ద మదర్ ఆఫ్ దట్ పురుష వ్యాఘ్ర, దట్ గ్రేట్ పర్సన్ రామ, అండ్ షీ ఈస్ దిస్ కౌసల్య. అండ్ సిమిలర్లీ హీ ఆల్సో ఇంట్రడ్యూసెస్ సే సుమిత్ర. She says, Asya Vamabhujam Shlishta, next to her, just on the left hand side, Yam Sumitra Dukkartha. This lady is Sumitra. Dukkartha, she is again very, very sad, and she is the mother of this Lakshmana and Shatrughna. And she introduces them like that. And coming to Kaikeyi, he says, Yasya Kurte Naravyagrav Jeevanashamito Gato. This is the lady for whose sake, because of whom this Purusha Vyagrav, Rama and Lakshmana, the two people who are comparable to mighty tigers. So these two people, they went to the forest, they lost their empire, then they lost their comforts in the empire, and Rama forsake his entire kingdom also, and then they went to forest along with Sita. And this is the lady for whom Dasharatha, he gave up his body. Dasharatha died because of this woman. And Krodhanam Akurta Prajnyam Druptam. Krodhana, very hot-tempered woman. Akurta Prajnya, whose brain is not well developed. And Drupta, very proud. Drupta is somebody who is very, very proud of his or her achievements. He or she is called Drupta. Then Subhagamaninim, considering herself as a great beauty, Subhaga, very, very great beauty. And Aishwarya Kamam, a person who is only interested in wealth, so introduces in these terms. So, she is unfortunately my mother, and because of her, I too feel ashamed. So, that is what say Bharata, that is how Bharata introduces. And he was just sighing like a sort of Kruddho Nagaiva Shwasan, you see. He was, even while introducing his mother, he was actually sighing like an enraged serpent, you see. Kruddho Nagaiva, like a very angry serpent, he was just sighing. And it is it is left to Bharadwaja to tell him, no, don't be angry with Kaikeyi, because everybody has, say, scorned Kaikeyi, everybody has, say, abused Kaikeyi, everybody has shunned Kaikeyi. So, please don't do that. What she has done is for the good of humanity. So, that is what he says, you see. Pratyuvacha Mahabuddhihi, what does he say? He says, na doshena avagantavya Kaikeyi Bharatatvaya, O my dear Bharata. Don't blame her. Don't blame her too much. Don't blame her unnecessarily. Rama pravrajanam hyetat sukhodarkam bhavishyati. This is for the good of everybody. This is for the good of mankind. He says, devanam danavanam cha rushinam bhavitatmanam. This is all for the good of the devas only. And for the end of all these danavas. And it is surely for the welfare of all the people, and hitameva bhavishyaddhi. It is for the good of everybody. So, don't blame. So, Bharadwaja is not very, very directly saying that Rama is having a great task ahead and all that, but he is hinting. He is hinting, and say, of course, these people, all the people have all the, say, they have been saying that Rama is the incarnation, Rama is an avatara. And everybody, Bharata accepts it, Lakshmana accepts, and all the people, they accept. So, probably they also would have got a hint, and probably this Bharadwaja is one man who has given some sort of consolation to say Kaikeyi, so that Kaikeyi is not further ashamed and say further humiliated. So, it is also good that way. He has sent a message that Kaikeyi should not be humiliated. So, thereafter all the people, they take leave of sage Bharadwaja, and they got on to various types of all different types of vehicles. And the army slowly moved on, and they marched in the deep jungle, you see, and marched in the deep jungle, Mahadvanam tat pratigahamana, Mahadvanam, that mighty forest. And when all these outside people, they go, the forest animals, they get panicky, and then they run hither and thither. So, that is what was happening, the forest animals running hither and thither. So, that is how that they take leave of sage Bharadwaja. We come to the next sarga, where Bharata is going as per the directions of sage Bharadwaja, and then he is approaching Chitrakuta. We see that, and again this whole sarga is a description of the forest. I am skipping almost all these shlokas, just one or two here I am just saying. All the animals are running away, and this army, as we have seen even earlier, it was moving like a sort of ocean. And then after they went ahead, and then after a lot of description of the jungle and what not, the scouts were going ahead. You see, whenever people march, some people are sent ahead, you see, that is called a scout. So, these scouts who went ahead, these are the people who just sometimes who get onto the trees, and then who see at a distance what is there. So, these people, they got onto some trees, and then they saw some smoke coming from a distance. So, that is how people in the jungle, they are detected. If some people are staying in a forest, any dense forest, the people who go in search of him look for various telltale signs. What are the telltale signs? Maybe some freshly cut branches, etcetera. Suppose you are going, there is a freshly cut branch. So, you can also see when exactly it was cut, whether it is a freshly cut one or a old cut or whatever it is. And if there is something else, some small pieces of food lying there, you will be able to say what is the age of that, how old is that food, etcetera. So, like that, and also at a distance you find the movement of birds, or at a distance you find some smoke, etcetera. So, these are the people who saw some smoke, and they thought, yes, surely there are some humans here, they may be Rama Lakshmana also, or they may be some rishis. That is how they think. And Bharata says, oh yeah, now let the army stay back, and I will go with Vasishtha and Sumantra. I will go with Vasishta, Sumantra, Ahameva Gamishyami, Sumantro Dhrutirevacha. With Vasishta and Sumantra, I will just go ahead. So, like that he says, and then he moves. And now we come to the next scene. The next scene is Rama. We now come to Rama. We have left Rama long ago, and now again we have come to Rama. He is showing the, he is say wandering on that hillock, you see, Chitrakuta. Lot many Kuta. Kuta means the peak. Chitrakuta means wonderful peaks. So, on those peaks, usually whenever you have, if we see, say for example, the closest example we all know is that Edukondalu, that is seven hills. Seven hills is that Tirumala. And though there are seven hills, on this, on the top of those seven hills, there is a plain area, that is where that Tirumala is located. So, like that, there will be some sort of open ground on the hillocks. So, Rama is just wandering on the, in that open ground, say showing the beauty of the forest to Sita. So, Atha Dasharathis Chitram Chitrakuta Madarshayat Bharyam Amarasankasha Shachimiva Purandaraha. They were moving like Lord Indra and his wife Shachi Devi. And he was saying, you see, Rama is saying, you see, how beautiful the forest is, and we can stay here any length of time, you see, and then I am forgetting the sorrow that we have gone away from the kingdom, we are away from that Ayodhya, we are missing Ayodhya, I am not feeling that I am missing Ayodhya, and with you around, I can stay, with you around and also Lakshmana serving us so dearly, we can stay here any longer, any length of time. So, he says, this sarga also, I am just skipping lot many shlokas, because lot many shlokas describing various types of trees and then various types of fruit bearing trees, flower bearing trees and all types of animals and what not and some other similes, say all those things I am skipping. And he says, anena vanavasena mama praptam phaladvayam pitruscha pitushcha anrunyata dharme bharatasya priyam tatha. So, he says, by coming to this vanavasa, I have achieved two things, you see. Maya praptam phaladvayam, I have achieved two things. What are they? Pitushcha anrunyata. You see, one thing is, I am redeemed from the debt I owe to my father. You see, pitrunam, we know that there are three types of runas. I think I told even earlier also, maybe I have told you. You see, every human being who is born on this earth, he is said to be born with three runas. Jayamano vai, tribhir runavan jayate, tribhihi runavan jayate, means by three things he is indebted. Like you now talk about the national debt and what not, we have got a concept of the national debt. For example, America owes several trillions of money to China, that is something like that. So, they say in America that every newborn child, he on his head some sort of so many, some $20,000 or some $15,000, that is the per capita debt on everybody's head. So, that is how we say. India, I am not very sure how much we owe to external debt, what is the external debt, and as soon as a baby is born, because of course, we have got the population is so huge that so it is so well distributed. So, on all of us, there will be some debt. So, like that in olden days, our people said, every human being, every person who is born, he is born with three types of runa, three types of debts. One is pitrunam, devarunam and rushirunam. And how are they to be? Rushirunam means say our indebtedness to the sages, our indebtedness to the devas and our indebtedness to our parents. And how are you going to redeem it? Indebtedness to rishis means, the rishis have given us a rich sampradaya, very rich heritage, and we are supposed to follow them, we are supposed to study it, we are supposed to propagate it, we are supposed to teach it, so to the posterity. So, that is how you are brahmacharyena rushibhyaha. Brahmacharyena rushibhyaha means, brahmacharya means what? Brahmacharya means not that you are not getting married for 30 years or 40 years, that is not brahmacharya. Brahmacharya is brahmani charati iti brahmachari, that is one who is focused on the reality. Brahma means what is the supreme reality, that is what is called Brahma in our tradition. Brahma is not that four-headed Brahma who is the husband of Saraswati and what not. Brahma means that supreme reality, what is called Brahma. And that brahmachari means one whose mind is focused on what is the supreme reality, who am I and what is this earth, this universe. So, this sort of philosophical speculation, a person who is engaged in that philosophical speculation is a brahmachari. not a person who is not married. So, brahmacharyena tapasa, say rushibhyaha. So, you are getting redeemed from the debt of these rushis by studying and also following, not only studying but also following and also swadhyaya pravachanecha. So, you have to study and also to teach. Then, praja, yajnena devebhyaha, by performing various types of yajna. Yajna, again, we should not think only of a sacrifice. There is some fireplace and then you are putting some ghee and somebody comes and says, "Are you are putting so much of costly ghee there and what not." We are not talking about that yajna. We have to go to Bhagavad Gita chapter 4 to know the elaborate meaning of yajna, where Lord Krishna gives a very, very comprehensive, very elaborate meaning of yajna. Yajna does not mean this narrow yajna where something is put into the fire, but any socially useful activity, any activity which is good, it is for, which is for the good of say others, that is what is called yajna. So, that is the reason why he says say gyana yajnaha, tapo yajnaha, dravya yajnaha, etc. He says different types of yajnas, and also self discipline is also a yajna. Swadhyaya jnana yajnyasya apare niyataharaha pranan praneshu juhvati, that is what he was saying. So, all these things, any socially useful activity or any activity which involves in self discipline, so that is what is yajna. So, yajnena devebhyaha, by doing this yajna, you are pleasing the deities, you are say repaying your debt to the devas. And how pitrubhyaha, this is the toughest thing. The toughest thing is we have to produce children. Prajaya pitrubhyaha, you have to produce children, your wife has to consent. Nowadays, that is the problem, the wives do not consent. This fellow wants, he gets married and he wants to have children. Sometimes the woman says, "No, we will not have children." So, that is a problem. But anyway, our people in the olden days, they did not have that problem. So, prajaya pitrubhyaha, by having children, why children? Not for increasing population and not for demography and not for votes, vote bank and what not. It is for the propagation of, say, continuance of dharma. A son, a father, he is performing, for example, a father, he has become too old to perform some rituals. And he is too old and then he becomes, physically unable. And it is for the son is supposed to perform on his behalf, so that the father gets that punya, father will not, he will not get that sort of negative, merit. So, it is the son who is supposed to do on behalf of the father also. So, that sort of, responsibility is put on the son. So, that is the reason why a son, not the number of sons, not number of sons which is mentioned, you have to have somebody who will continue that sort of dharma. So, that is, it may be son, daughter, whatever it is. So, that is why that is an indebtedness. So, Rama says, by this vanavasa, anena vanavasena, phaladvayam, I got this phaladvayam. Number one is pituscha anrunyata. I got redeemed from the death of my, from the debt I owe to my father. That is, the very fact that he, sacrificed his kingdom for the sake of, for making his father's word truthful. So, that is a great, sacrifice. So, by that, I became, free from that debt. And Bharatasya priyam tatha. And number two, I have done something which is good for Bharata, and then I have done some help to Bharata. Bharatasya hitam. I have done that which will be liked by Bharata. So, he says like that. And similarly, the whole chapter goes in the description of that forest. Now, while Rama and Sita, they come, they were walking, they just come close to Ganga. So, that is what we see here, because this Chitrakuta is also on the banks of Ganges. So, now the next sarga, that is 95th sarga, there is a description of the beauty of Ganga, you see, the whole sarga, 95th sarga, the whole description of the river Ganga. Probably such passages were introduced basically to instill some sense of bhakti among the readers, because Ramayana is an epic, and in this epic there are so many passages and so many sargas. Why whole sarga is dedicated for the glory of Ganga? So, glory of Ganga is people do some parayana. Some people who want some punyam, you see, they exclusively do some parayana of Ganga stuti. And of course, there are certain Ganga stutis also exclusively. So, for that reason, and probably after reading this, people will be inclined, oh, let me see Ganga sometime. So, that sort of feeling will be there, oh, Ganga, Ganges is so sacred, I have to see Ganga. So, for various reasons, these epic writers, they included various things, keeping in mind various things. So, because the large, very large audience, you know, very large audience and different types of people, different say tastes and different inclinations. So, the epic writer has to look after everybody, he has to understand everybody. So, here you see there are, he is describing how beautiful that river Ganges is, and lot many say fruit bearing and flower bearing trees are on the side, and several rishis who are staying all along the banks of say Ganges in various mountain caves and all. You see, even today it is there. I was telling you even earlier, if you go to places like Rishikesh or Haridwar and places like that, the particularly Rishikesh is so close to the mountains, Himalayas, and you can physically see, there are that certain caves and whatnot, and in those caves you find some, nowadays electrical lights are also there. In olden days, of course, they were not there. So, the people even now, they are living in such places, some ashramas, some small Swamiji who is staying there. So, various rishis were doing tapas and all that, and some people, of course, say at that time, probably it was afternoon, many people had come down to the Ganges, you see, many people had come down, and Aditya Upatishthante Niyamad Urdhvabahu means raising their hands up, they are doing the Suryopasthana, what is called Suryopasthana, in the morning and also in the afternoon and also in the evening, three times a day, these people, they do Sandhyavandana. So, they go, they get into the water and then they take the river waters and then they offer this what is called Arghyam to say Surya. So, that is what they do, that Suryopasthanam, it appears to be this Madhyanikam, and after that he also humors a little, humors Sita a little bit, you see, oh, Tvam Paurajanavat Vyalan. You see, all around we find all these wild animals also, all these wild animals, you treat them, let us treat them like our citizens, and you consider this mountain as Ayodhya, and this stream, this Ganga which is flowing, this is like our Sarayu. So, he is humoring like that, and here we will be doing this Trishavana Snanam. Upasprushan Trishavanam. It is time also for Rama to perform his Sandhyavandanam. So, that is what he is saying. Upasprushan Trishavanam. That is what is called Trishavana Snanam. That is, three times a day we are supposed to take bath. We see that this practice was there even in North India, you see. I thought it was there only in South. This practice is there even in the North India. So, Trishavana Snanam, he says, and by happily staying here, I will even forget even Ayodhya, I will forget kingdom, everything I will forget, he says. And that is how they slowly say come to a river, and then they also, he is asking that Sita to get down into water, and that is where we come to the end of this particular sarga. And we come to the next sarga, 96 sarga, we will continue in the next episode, because again this 96 sarga describes how these people, they detect there is some sort of movement of animals, unnatural movement of of animals. So, what is the reason? So, that is what they will try to find out. We will continue in the next episode. Harihi Om Tat Sat.